Next to this quarry, a group called the Quarrymen performed at a village fete. There are no plaques or signposts, but at the side of this picturesque quarry is one of the most significant sites in the whole history of rock and roll, because this, in this ground here, is where Paul McCartney first saw John Lennon perform with the Quarrymen, where they first got together. And from here, the whole history of rock and roll was to change, and Liverpool was to become the rocking city, create a type of rock and roll, and take it right back to the home of rock and roll in America. I'm here at St. Peter's Village Hall, just a short walk away from the village fete where the Quarrymen played, about 20 yards from the gravestone of a certain Eleanor Rigby. And in this very room, rock and roll was redefined when Paul sat down to chat with John, and John started playing some chords on his guitar, and Paul started writing out some lyrics for him, and the two of them began to chat, realized that they had a closeness between them almost straight away. And as a result, the huge explosion and exciting new rock and roll hit the world in the 60s, and it was all born in this very room. The two of them got together, met, were kindred spirits, and soon after, one of John's friends went up to Paul and said, "John wants you to join the group."
In the Liverpool home where he lived with his aunt and uncle, John Lennon dreamed of becoming a rock star like Elvis Presley. Just down the road lived Paul McCartney, whose father once played in a ragtime band. George Harrison, who lived in this house and rode the bus to school every day with Paul, idolized guitarist Duane Eddy. Growing up near the city's docks, Ringo Starr played drums with Liverpool's biggest rock band, the Hurricanes, until he met the Beatles in Hamburg, Germany.
None of them had been abroad before, and suddenly we're in this neon-lit street with all sorts of sex shops and gangsters on the door, and they were just boggled-eyed. They served their musical apprenticeship in Hamburg. They worked sometimes from 6 o'clock at night till 3 o'clock in the morning. And they exploded on stage. The bouncers thought, "Oh my God, there's a fight." And it wasn't, it was the explosion of the Beatles.
And then we went back to Liverpool and got quite a few bookings. You know, they all thought we were German. You know, we billed us from Hamburg, and they all said, "You speak good English."
And Brian suggested that we just sort of wore ordinary suits. So we just got what we thought were quite good suits and just got rid of the leather gear.
Bands like ourselves and the Beatles and the Big Three and the Searchers and everyone, we all tried to be unique and play our own type of music, what we liked, and tried to get our own sound. And because we all were resident at the Cavern Club, it was that was the place to come and see all the bands.
It wasn't just the music when you went to see the Beatles. You knew you were going to come out on a high, an absolute high.
This is Matthew Street. This is where the Cavern Club was a really raving place in the 60s. Started off as a trad jazz club, and then the swinging blue jeans made the place very popular with the blue jeans night out. And then the Beatles started to play here, and all the other groups like the Searchers and Jerry and the Pacemakers. And this is where the Cavern was. People ask me about the Cavern, and I always tell them that it was sweaty, it smelt, but to me it was the best rock and roll place that ever was, you know. And in the early 60s, it was a place where kids could rock and roll and have fun without anybody getting on their backs. And it was a tremendous atmosphere, and I don't know why, but I always thought that the Beatles sounded better at the Cavern than anywhere. You know, they were a lot more ballsy than the records.
Brian Epstein, when he went down to the Cavern, which is, Brian hung out in a completely different world. He was rich. He had a successful family, successful furniture business that had a small record store in it, which is how people kept coming in and saying, "Hey, have you got that that record of the Beatles and Tony Sheridan, that My Bonnie Lies Over the Air? Have you got that record?" And after like the 40th time of kids coming in asking for the record, he said, "Well, you know, maybe I better get this record." And he stocked the record in, he sold it out, he got another 1,000, he sold that out, and he said, "Well, who are these kids? And they said, well, they're playing at this place called the Cavern. Why don't you go down and check them out?
The Beatles were then just four lads on that rather dimly lit stage. I was immediately struck by their music, their beat, and their sense of humor, actually, on stage. And even afterwards, when I met them, I was struck again by their personal charm. And it was there that really it all started.
We do like the fans and enjoy reading the publicity about us, but from time to time you don't realize that it's actually about yourself.
And once, when the boys came for me, they popped in to see me mum and my dad, you know. We had to go out the back because, you know, there's 20 or 30 outside. And they wouldn't believe me, mother, you know, they'd knock in saying, can we have their autographs?
The Beatles came down themselves about 2:30 in the morning, 3:00, and they were talking to us and signing autographs, and then they went away, and then we sort of all sat down, and some of the lazy ones sort of fell asleep, but the rest of us just kept awake on coffee and dreams of the Beatles.
Beatles were like a gift from God. I was just at the perfect age for that, 14. Gave us all an identity. And I've thought before, just for the music, it was such a bonus that the music was like the best music ever.
I was Beatles all the way, man. I was my bedroom wall was in fact completely covered. The walls, ceilings, doors, any Beatle pictures were stuck on my wall, and I used to have these fantasies of Paul McCartney marrying my sister and all this kind of crazy stuff, you know, and how wonderful it all was.
You're going over to the States early in the new year, and you're going to top the bill on the Ed Sullivan Coast to Coast show. John, so far, all British pop stars have not made a tremendous impact on the States. How do you think you're going to fare?
Well, I can't really say, can I? I mean, is it up to me? No. I mean, I just hope we go all right, you know.
Are you going to vary your act at all for the American audience?
No, I mean, we haven't really got an act, so we'll just do what we do.
I went to New York with the boys, and you would see men of, you know, middle-aged men walking down Fifth Avenue with Beatle wigs on their heads. And no matter where you turned your dial on the radio, at any time of the day, you would hear a Beatles song. It was complete saturation. I think life for the Beatle in the early days was very tough. Once the success had come, once they were not only a success in England, but also broke the breaches in America, then they lived in a giant goldfish bowl and they couldn't escape.
The British invasion this time goes by the codename Beatlemania. D-Day has been common knowledge for months, and this was the day.
The Beatles are coming, the Beatles are coming. They got bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger until finally we got to the point where they landed at the airport in New York, and there was like 50,000 people there. It was unbelievable.
That's it. This is it. It's all over, but the shouting. We had never seen an airport that you couldn't get to because of kids standing out there screaming. We'd never seen kids fainting like that at concerts. We never heard screams like that, that you couldn't even hear the music while the guys and you knew they were playing. We knew that there was a problem and it had just landed.
I knew that they were different, and I knew that their voices blended together, and I knew they had a great talent. And I knew they were going to be big, and I hated them for that.
What do you think of the comment that you're nothing but a bunch of British Elvis Presley?
Oh, it's not true, it's not true.
Are you going to get a haircut while you're here?
Nope, no, no, thanks.
I had one yesterday.
That's no lie.
Truth. I remember I came downstairs one day, I combed my hair down, a Beatle haircut, and my father laughed. He thought that was so funny. And then when he realized that I wasn't going to comb it back again, he got really pissed off.
These girls were losing their minds. I mean, this appealed to me in a very fundamental way. I think I was about 13 or 14, and these girls were going nuts.
I was pregnant with Kenya, my daughter, when the Beatles thing swept, okay? And I remember I Want to Hold Your Hand, and I'd be in the kitchen just sweeping and cooking and taking care of the babies and singing I Want to Hold Your Hand.
I was so taken with I Want to Hold Your Hand that I stayed up all night because I didn't have a copy of it and I wanted to hear it. They played it once an hour, I think.
When we saw what happened with the Beatles, we got together and had a meeting and said, look, now what are we going to do here? We're getting eclipsed by a group called the Beatles from London. Oh, my God. We were completely jealous as hell. I guess we might have turned our motors on, trying to get something happening where we would be better musically than the Beatles.
We always take my car because it's never been beat, and we've never missed yet with the girls we meet. None of the guys go steady because it wouldn't be right to leave the best girl home now on Saturday night. Get around, round, round, I get around. Get around, I get around, yeah, get around, round, round, I get around.
The Beach Boys were hugely important, demonstrating what you could do in a studio and what you couldn't do in a studio and opening up. And Motown had already done that to some extent. You know, Motown had actually shown that black pop dance music, R&B dance music, could just be extraordinarily beautiful to listen to and beautifully produced and elegant. And it's very, very big influence.
When we first started to make a bunch of hits in Detroit, and we called it the Motown sound, people were coming from Africa. They were coming from England. They were coming from Chicago and New York and Nashville and Memphis to record their people in Detroit because they thought they were gonna get the Motown sound, like it was in the air somewhere.
Motown is history, Motown is the greatest, and it will always be a Motown. And when you look at Motown and listen to Motown and listen to any artist that comes from Motown, you'll think of Berry Gordy, Stevie Wonder, the Supremes, the Four Tops, Marvin Gaye, Temptations. You have to think of just these people because there was a foundation of the Detroit sound, and it lives today, and it will always live.
Music at the time, like the Beach Boys and Motown, really didn't affect us because that was still American music. America at the time was hung up from these daft people from England, these Scousers from Liverpool, singing this daft, happy music that they enjoyed doing. So the Motown scene didn't matter to us, really. We had our own niche with the American public.
1964 was the beginning of the British invasion when the Beatles finally broke down the barriers And I guess that because it'd been pent up so much, because people were waiting it, there had been singles released on little labels, it came with a big rush. And in that breach poured lots of British talent after it.
Catch you crying. The night's the time for all your tears. Your heart may be broken tonight, but tomorrow in the morning light, don't let the sun catch you crying.
I actually wrote it for my girlfriend. We had an argument one evening and she said, we're finished. And I thought, how can I get her to come back to me? So I wrote Don't Let the Sun Catch You Crying for her, and I sent it to her on a tape. And 2 days later, she rang me back and she said, Jerry, can we get back together again? That young girl from all those years ago is now my wife.
All the morning will bring joy for every girl and boy. So don't let the sun catch you crying. Don't let the sun catch you crying. Oh no, whoa, whoa, whoa.
We were always impressed by the English bands, largely because a lot of the bands that came over here were just the cream of the English bands. Over here, we're exposed to every band. And of course, there's really bad bands, and there's really good bands, and everything in between. But the ones that would make it over here from England were the best of England.
A lot of people have come up to me and said that the first time that they had heard The Animals and heard Housewives and Son was on the Chuck Berry tour. When we met Chuck Berry, he was instrumental in making The Animals really successful in America.
The cold rising sun, yeah, and it's been the ruin of many old boys. And God, I know.
We were on tour with Chuck Berry, and every band in Britain wanted to be on that tour. The Stones were standing in line. Everybody was making agent, managerial, political overtures to get on the Chuck Berry tour. And we pulled it off. And I realized that if you try to out-rock Chuck Berry, you're wasting your time. So I was looking for a song that wouldn't be and would have a different feel to it, but that would be very erotic and very atmospheric. So we sang House of Rising Sun.
Oh, mother, tell your children, yeah, not to do what I have done. Spend your lives in sin and misery in a house.
The Animals first went to America. We flew into Kennedy Airport, and the pilot told the passengers that we had to be taken to a separate part of the airport because the fans were mobbing security guards, were creating mayhem at reception. And then we were hustled into a car, taken to an airport building. We stood behind, and there was a press conference with loads of chaps with cameras and notebooks all sitting there very noisily. And then they asked us to go onto the stage, and they said, do something. Animals, do something, roar, growl. And all of a sudden, we're standing in front, you know, like animals in a zoo being told to perform. Then we were hustled through customs, and they thought it would be a great exercise to be filmed going into New York, and they'd got all these British sports cars back. And we had to sit perched, you know, very precariously on the back of these sports cars, and we'd driven all the way from Kennedy Airport into the center of Manhattan, waving at non-existent crowds. And we were opening at the Paramount Theater in New York, and we did 50 shows in 10 days.
There was a great sense of brotherhood, great sense of, hey, we're all in this together, and let's go to America and kick ass, you know.
The Animals and the Stones were very similar to the Northwest bands, that raw edge to them, the roughness. They weren't in suits, they were sort of anti-establishment, but we were all cowboy fanatics at the time. We liked all the Western movies from Hollywood, like all the John Ford movies. And we thought, well, hang on, we'll go the opposite way. We call ourselves The Searchers, after the John Wayne movie. But with Needles and Pins, it was such a big number one for us. It was number one for 4 weeks.
I saw her today. I saw her face. It was a face I loved. And I knew I had to run away. And get down on my knees and pray. That they go away, but still they didn't. She's wasting him in me. Let her go ahead. Take his love and stay. And one day she will see just how to say please.
Image was very important. Name was very important. Behavior was very important. Music was kind of important. What was more important than the music that you played was where the music you played originated. And for the Stones, they played blues.
4 months after the Beatles appeared on the Ed Sullivan Show, the Rolling Stones landed in America. The band had taken its name from a song by bluesman Muddy Waters, and their barreling style from rock pioneer Chuck Berry.
I see the joint was rocking, going round and round. Yeah, reeling and a rocking, what a crazy sound. And they never stopped rocking till the moon went down. It sounds so sweet.
The British were going straight to the sources, man. Willie Dixon, you know, Chuck Berry. Well, they were going right straight where it came from. And they hit it hard, you know, because they knew that's the Delta blues and everything else. They knew exactly what the sources were because they were students of American music, and much more so than American musicians were. They gave everybody a run for their money.
My first impression of the Rolling Stones was, yeah, that's the band I want to be in. I'm going to be in that band. And, you know, it's amazing what the imagination and a bit of fate and determination can do.
The first tour was tough. We were popular in New York and popular in LA, but the rest of it, forget it. You know, we used to play empty stadiums and, you know, it was tough, and America then was very, very conservative in its attitudes.
We had a little motel with a swimming pool. It was right next to a freeway. Obviously, some outraged Southern couple had driven by and seen these long-haired people with no bras on around the swimming pool. About 5 minutes later, wee, 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 up come the state troopers, good old redneck boys, and, you know, to arrest these chicks for topless bathing. And they're like, whatever, you know, what? Yeah, so they're taken aback. We don't understand why we're supposed to be arrested anyway, because we're not, I'm sorry, I left the bra in London, right?
Why do you like the Rolling Stones?
Because Keith is beautiful, and they're great, and because they're so ugly that they're appealing.
I think the greatest, they're dressed different, and the best things that ever happened in the United States.
We could see where we had an audience, where we did have an audience, we went down really well, and they loved it. So we could see where we were going to get, and we had supporters, we had disc jockeys that liked our records and so on. But anyway, we knew we'd have to come back and do it again and again and again and again and again. But it was a bit scary. I mean, we had some very scary moments. I remember one moment that scared me very much. We were in a limo coming to a gig, and the whole thing was just engulfed with, like, people just all over the limo. And I thought, no one's coming here. We're just going to stuck in this limo. What's actually going to happen?
The Rolling Stones had a big influence on everybody as to what to do and what not to do.
No, they're the they're the best example of doing the right thing and then doing the wrong thing, you know.
The Beatles were the good boys and the Stones were the bad boys. And I think being the bad boys may have been more fun, and I think the Beatles may have been jealous of that.
Beatles and the Stones were always friends, but they were also rivals. And the Stones were kind of upstarts in a way. They came almost, but a little bit later than the Beatles. And I guess the Stones were the image that the mothers didn't want, where the Beatles became the image that the mothers did want. So in a way, that worked against the Beatles, who they really wanted to be as rough and tough as the Stones.
I woke up in the middle of the night, put it down to maybe a minute of da, 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 da. I can't get no satisfaction. And woke up the next morning and looked at my cassette machine and seen that it's gone from the beginning of the tape to the end. Now, I don't remember doing any of this.
What people said about it was that the lyrics were kind of very direct. I just wrote what I felt, really.
Rock and roll type people than the Beatles or the Stones, and what happened? The Beatles made it, and Jerry and the Pacemakers made it, and the Searchers made it, and Billy J. Kramer and the Dakotas made it, and there were no bands left. They'd all become stars and gone to London, and they were touring in the big building, so the only club band left, basically, the best of what was left, was Herman's Hermits.
Woke up this morning feeling fine.
Every band had to be different, otherwise you couldn't survive. You had to find your thing. And Herman's Hermits chose to go the pop sound. I couldn't write songs like John Lennon or Paul McCartney. I couldn't, I looked silly wearing the leather clothes. You know, I didn't look like a Gene Vincent type character. And I didn't, I wasn't part of a band, so we chose to be like a pop band. We went, let's do good romantic songs. Let's make records like old movies where everyone lives happily ever after.
I asked to see her and she told me I could. Something tells me I'm into something good.
Something tells me I'm into something.
Something tells me I'm into.
I had become friendly with Paul McCartney and had heard this song that he'd written called World Without Love, which the Beatles had apparently declined to do, but I'd heard it and thought that it was a song Gordon and I could probably sing reasonably well. And so I asked Paul, I said, you know, we've got this record contract now, we're gonna go and cut some songs. Could you finish that song? Because it was unfinished, it didn't have a bridge. And he finished it, wrote the bridge, and we went and recorded it. Fortunately, it was a big hit.
So I wait. Your love smile,
she may come, I know not when. When she does, I am known. So baby, until then, lock me away. And don't allow the day here inside where I hide with my loneliness. I don't care what they say, I won't stay in a world without love.
It really wasn't until the Beatles and the whole English invasion that I became just a crazed Anglophile and would pick up anything I could about English bands, particularly ones that weren't even available in the States. But it was always English music for me. That was the turning point.
The Kinks were much more quintessentially English. You know, I always think that Ray Davies should be one day be poet laureate. You know, he invented a new kind of poetry and a new kind of language for pop writing, which I think, you know, influenced me from the very, very, very beginning.
The Kinks were completely crazy, completely. They would do things like cut all the wires to the electricity while you were playing. Just cut them with pliers. They would throw things at you while you were playing. And they were completely nuts. But once you heard that you really got me, you knew that they were destined for fame and glory.
Girl, you really got me going. You got me so I don't know what I'm doing now. Yeah, you really got me now. You got me so I can't sleep at night. Yeah, you really got me now. You got me so I don't know what I'm doing now. Oh, yeah, you really got me now. You got me so...
London was the known center of the universe as far as the 60s were concerned. I'm not saying that in a conceited manner at all. It's where the fashion was emanating from. Politics were unfolding.
Carnaby Street was for the kids coming in on the tube, you know, to think they were buying what Londoners were buying. If Eric Clapton wore a suit, you know, with wide lapels, like a Georgian suit, it very quickly appeared in Carnaby Street.
I mean, it really was all the Carnaby Street thing, fantastic clubs. It's a memory that you don't have to sort of romanticize. It was very, very real.
All of a sudden, kids had to have long hair like they had in England. We almost began to talk like Englishmen. We wore the same clothing. All sorts of things happened with the look that we borrowed from England.
We took how we looked and we took fashion and all that stuff very seriously. I remember thinking a lot about that, how I would have to look.
Energy in London and the energy around the music, and then the Stones, there was this onward going battle, which was they were all in down the clubs together, but it was all like, you know, where are you on the charts today? And it was all very real, you know, and the pumping records out, and they were so prolific.
Andrew Oldham was very keen that we write songs because of the obvious reasons. First, we got more money. One of those was As Tears Go By, which Marian Faithfull recorded, and that was quite a good one. But again, it was a song written for a woman, more or less. But it became a hit because it was a better song and she was very good looking and Andrew promoted it and so on. And we promoted it because we wrote it, by which time we were quite well known. So the whole thing of it took off.
I did realize that it was a very strange song for a 17-year-old to sing. And of course, it's haunted me all my life and probably always will.
It took me a long time to really like it. I couldn't, I guess, until I really became more the right age. Shaking, my knees were knocking together, which of course was incredibly charming, I suppose, for the audience to see this beautiful little blonde angelic creature shaking with fear, listening to people judging as tears go by. Ah!
I always liked the British sound, but we was getting fearful for a minute because they was getting ready to dominate the charts. So it was kind of like a fearful thing in Motown. Wow, what's going to happen? But it really didn't hurt at all. It's just that they had this space and we just had ours. And it was really a great compliment to everybody that these two musics were really dominating the charts.
There were so many Motown artists who were all good. I mean, it was just like a stable of talented people. And when I listen to some of the Supremes, they are just like bigger than the Beatles as far as I'm concerned, but they never got that recognition. And that always bothered me, because the Supremes were the biggest things happening. I need
touring the South in 1965 with the Supremes. The theory being both of us were going to increase our audience base, and we were both anxious to share in some of the others' audience. Provided a direct rebuttal to the English invasion. People kind of expected us to imitate the Beatles in a lot of ways that we didn't.
What happened to America in this crisis of confidence when the Beatles and Freddie and the Dreamers even were wiping out American bands was America looked at the situation, assessed it, and within a very short time, by the end of 65-6, it was back in business. I was feeling so bad. I asked my family doctor just what I had. I said, doctor, doctor, Mr. MD, doctor, can you tell me what's ailing me, doctor?
In our neck of the woods, they were a pretty popular band. The Rascals say, like, I never noticed a Hammond organ in my life till I saw the Rascals. And then we went and scrounged up somebody's old Hammond organ. And here's a whole other texture of sound.
People don't realize the contribution the Rascals made were the Uptown Band. And, you know, they had this vicious rhythm section. I mean, it was popping between Felix's left hand and Dino Danelli. I mean, it was great. There was also a tremendous amount of competition between bands. It was a very competitive thing between the East Coast and the West Coast. The Byrds were the West Coast guys at the time.
We became this very free, unstructured act on stage and did what we pleased and built around a real song-oriented show. And the vocals were great. Gene Clark was a fine lead singer, and McGuinn and Crosby, and we were really turning into a pretty decent band. It was starting to sound real musical.
But we couldn't turn down a trip to England because that was where the Beatles and the Stones came from. And we thought there might be something in the water over there that made you sound better. We didn't know what it was, but we wanted to go over there. So we went over there, and our unscrupulous promoter had billed us as America's answer to the Beatles.
I mean, the Byrds were not in the Beatles class ever, you know. We became a good band, you know, and we had a lot of good ideas, but we were not the America's answer to Bug Spray, let alone the Beatles.
In the early 60s, the only people in L.A. were the Beach Boys and a few other bands. And then once we started out there, then a lot of the bands started coming out to L.A. It seemed like the Byrds kind of were a catalyst for that music scene to develop into more of an alternative area.
I was dropped in my head on my, as I was, you know, I was 3 years old. Somebody was throwing me in the air and catching me, and they called his name, and it was the other way, and I went... So I've heard harmony ever since. When I hear a melody, I hear harmony to it. It's strange.
I mean, John arranged everything that the Mamas and the Papas ever did. He was the vocal arranger from heaven, you know? I mean, he just had a great, great magical touch.
John and Mitchie were getting kind of itchy just to leave the folk music behind. Saul and Denny working for a penny, trying to get a fish on the line. In a coffee house Sebastian sat, and after every number they had that. Quinn and McGuire's just a getting.
Creek Alley was just all of our friends who were in California and who were there and here and there, and what they were doing, what was going on. The Lovin Spoonful and the Byrds.
Saul said, "Danny, you know there are many who can sing a song the way that you do. Let's go south."
Michelle was the very first runaway in California. She was the atypical California girl that Brian Wilson wrote his song about, California Girls. She was absolutely ravishingly beautiful. And had long blonde hair and didn't wear shoes and had beads and had run away, and she was 16 years old. A real delight.
Well, Cass was a sophomore, planned to go to Swarthmore, but she changed her mind one day. Standing on the turnpike, come out to hitchhike, take her to New York right away. Well, Jenny met Cassie, gave a love.
Denny had one of the most beautiful voices I'd ever heard. So Denny and Michelle and I started singing together.
High jumps, low stops, big bumps, don't you work as hard as you play.
We started to sing as a trio. And everywhere we went, he was always on the phone with this girl that he was talking to. Constantly, everywhere we went, every city we went to, he was on the phone. With this girl named Cass. And we said, so who is this chick? Is she your girlfriend?
And everybody's getting fat except Mama Cass.
We decided that we were gonna really keep everything in the song factual. We weren't going to take any liberties, you know. And John is a very, very clever writer, you know, and the whole song was completed in about 3 hours.
From LA to London, rock was now a truly international phenomenon. And back in England, new bands were busy developing a cocky edge. They were led by The Who and Pete Townsend, who made a ritual out of demolishing his electric guitar on stage.
You have to remember that The Who broke, you know, a full year and a half, really, after The Stones and The Beatles had broken, maybe more than that. And by that time, we were allowed to be angry. You know, the Stones and the Beatles had broken enough rules. So our anger wasn't all our own anger. Our anger was, you know, a reflection of the anger that we felt from people in the audience. I wrote it as a series of songs about my inability to express what I felt to women. A couple of kids came up and said, you know, that was great, that was great. And I said, you know, it's just about some kid who can't explain, you know, what he thinks. And they said, that's it, that's it, that's us, you know. And that was really when I realized that I'd been voted in as spokesman for that bunch of kids.
Most of the scene was actually happening in London. There was a kind of an invisible line that went from just north of London to the rest of England. And it wasn't until the Beatles broke through and became very successful that it changed all that geographically. We came up with Carrie Anne. That was originally Marianne. We actually wrote it about Marianne Faithful, but didn't have the guts to call it Marianne, so we call it Carrie Anne, you know, a name we'd made up, we'd never heard of.
When it came out, I wondered if it was written for me, but I sort of brushed it aside, like I always have done, really. Oh, no, no, of course it wouldn't have been.
The bands for me that meant a lot, primarily the Beatles, without question, above all, the Kinks and the Small Faces. And somewhere behind them, other groups like, you know, the Spencer Davis Group.
Was now known as this child prodigy, a title that he didn't take to very kindly, I can assure you. You know, he didn't like it. He wanted to be a musician. He wanted to be one of the boys.
Hey.
March of 1966, John Lennon made an off-the-cuff remark suggesting that the Beatles were bigger than Jesus. His comments caused an uproar. In America's conservative Bible Belt, records were burned and protest organized.
I think John's remark about Jesus Christ obviously was a stupid thing to do. I don't think he meant what the way it was interpreted. He didn't mean to say, hey, we're bigger than Jesus. What he meant to say was that Jesus, or rather Christianity, didn't seem to be as popular as the Beatles. Oh, the burning of Beatle records and the general sort of anti-Beatle element that arose was very disturbing. It was pretty rough stuff. And as you know, John actually made an apology, saying he didn't mean it that way. But if he did upset people, he was really sorry about it.
Well, I'm not saying that we're better or greater or comparing us with Jesus Christ as a person or God as a thing or whatever it is. You know, I just said what I said and it was wrong or was taken wrong and now it's all this.
Fame, if you have too much of it, is a pretty heavy penance, and it got very wearing and it was in danger of destroying their lives. So it was difficult for them to cope with that. I think that was one of the reasons why they wanted to relax into the studio more.
The Beatles came, and the whole English invasion behind that. And suddenly here was something that was of my own generation, because I had kind of, it was a strange thing to really soak up the 50s music at the age of 12, when it was really all over.
It was just great. It was really exciting, fresh, and interesting. And they were very good. It's really musical, and they're funny. And yeah, what can you say about the Beatles? They really transformed popular music.
That's something that I guess we've taken from the Beatles, this thing of never trying to repeat yourself, always keep moving.
These poor guys from Liverpool were stealing a march on us. It was a slap, it was a bother for a while, you know, especially since they were successful and we weren't. But we met them real early. They heard about us and came down to see us. And one night in some club, and suddenly they were regular guys. We started talking guitars and songs and stuff, you know, because at that time Mick and I hadn't considered writing songs. You know. In fact, I mean, if it wasn't for the Beatles, we probably never would have.
I see my red door and I want it painted black. No colors anymore, I want them to turn red. I see the girls walk by dressed in their summer clothes. I have to turn to fill my dark clothes. I see a line of cars and they're all painted black. Flowers and my love hope never to come back.
The British invasion had the biggest impact on, you know, the stuff that was coming out of England, the Animals and Stones and the Beatles. And then I went back and discovered a lot of the blues roots and the soul roots and the original records. And...